Hello, everyone. Father Mark here with our first installment of Saint of the Month. As part of our new initiative, Together in Faith, we're excited to offer this look into a life of a certain saint. Hopefully that kind of fits within the theme of the month that we're offering to you. So as I thought about who I wanted to present first and foremost, I thought about Giovanni Bernardoni, perhaps the most famous of saints, certainly none more famous, respected by Muslims, respected by Hebrews, revered by Catholics, and respected by Christians of all denominations. That's obviously his secular name. Take a second, maybe perhaps within the household, to see if anybody who knows who his saint name is. Giovanni is born towards the end of the 12th century in the hill country of central Italy. His father is Pietro Bernardoni, and Pietro's wife's name is Pica. Pietro is a wealthy cloth merchant, and he does quite a bit of traveling in his trade, quite often going to France and other countries, not just other cities within central Italy. Pica is a very, very devout Catholic woman whose faith means the world to her. Very, very devout. So while Pietro is away on a business trip, Pica gives birth to a son. Wanting to get her son baptized right away, she names him Giovanni, and that's after John the Baptist. So you get a real kind of feel for how strong her faith is. Pietro, on the other hand, comes back into town after his long trip, and he's not happy to hear that she has named him Giovanni. See, he does not want his son to go into the religious life. He wants him to follow into his footsteps as a businessman. So he takes to nicknaming him the name of Francesco. So it's maybe starting to take shape. Now we come to understand that this young man would eventually become Saint Francis. Saint Francis in that hill country in Italy is Assisi. So Saint Francis of Assisi is born Giovanni Bernardoni. So this tension or this difference between the two ideologies of how to live life, between his mother and his father, are really, it's kind of a tension that he'll bounce back and forth from between his entire life. Initially, he follows in his father's footsteps, and his father is very, very happy with who Francis is. He has a wonderful personality. People are drawn to him. He's a real leader. He has the means to be able to lavish some gifts upon his friends and throw parties. So he really is just kind of, everybody likes Francis. I mean, everybody likes Francis. He just has that wonderful personality. But he also has his interior disposition towards faith. It's just not very, very important to him. He really follows in his father's footsteps. When he gets into his late teenage years, he grows tired of this lifestyle. He wants to do something a little bit more noble. And at this time in history, to be noble would be a soldier, and more specifically, to be a knight. So he has these dreams of grandeur, of being this famous knight who goes off into war in great victories. He comes home and is lavished with praise and so forth. So he becomes a soldier and joins in with the army. And specifically, he goes on the very, very first war. He's actually, the town of Assisi's army is actually decimated, and they lose the battle. A lot of soldiers are killed, and a lot of them are captured and taken prisoners. Because Francis came from a wealthy family, they held him ransom until his father Pietro would pay the ransom fee. It took a year, but eventually he does pay the ransom, and Francis is brought home. Nothing really changes. He continues his kind of party lifestyle. And it wasn't really until the next war that the town of Assisi went on that his life began to change. As he begs his father for a new suit of armor. It's a big, fancy, beautiful, expensive suit of armor. He gets on his horse and he is galloping into towards a battle. It's a couple of days ride away, and about a day into it, while he's sleeping, he has a dream. The dream is very, very clear that the Lord is saying to him, this isn't what I have in mind for you. So he gets back on his horse, turns around, and walks back to Assisi while the rest of the soldiers move on. So he's going to come back a failure in many people's eyes. They don't understand, is he a coward? What's going on here? But this is this interior movement. This was a profound moment in his life. He comes back into town, and yes, they begin to make fun of him. The townspeople are kind of chastising him for not having more courage. But his prayer life begins to kind of really blossom. So he leaves town on one particular day on his horse to go and pray into the mountains where he enjoyed praying. And he just has a moment of fulfillment, and he decides that it's time to go back into town. As he's walking his horse back into town, and he approaches and he sees a man in the distance. And as he gets closer and takes a good look at him, he begins to understand that this man is a leper who has been thrown out of town, who's not allowed to go into town. Filled with compassion, Francis gets off his horse, walks up to the man, grabs his hand, kisses his hand, and embraces him. So now we know that he's a leper. He doesn't really know what compelled him to do so, but he just had this inner movement to go be compassionate. He gives him all the money that he has at his, on his possession. He hops back on his horse and begins to walk back into town. He gets just a short ways away, and he says to himself that he needs to turn back and take a look at this man one last time. And when he turns around, the man is not there. Now, this is in the middle of the countryside. There's nowhere for that man to have gone. So he takes this as a sign from God. He feels like he's been tested by God and that he's passed. And his heart is just filled with love. It's an encounter, so he believes that was an encounter with Christ himself. So he goes back into town and really spends his life deeply in prayer. Goes to the local church, begins to pray on a daily basis in the local church. And as he's standing in front of a crucifix on one particular day, he hears a voice that says to him, Francis, rebuild my church. Rebuild my church. He is taken aback by this and doesn't quite know what to do, but he's going to follow through. He feels like it's the Lord leading him in a certain direction. But he thinks that what he's been asked to do is to physically rebuild the church. So he doesn't have any money to actually buy the materials to rebuild this church that was a little dilapidated. So what he does is he goes to his father's business and he takes some cloth and he sells the cloth and takes the money to rebuild the church. His father finds out and he is furious because he's done this without his permission. So in a small town, the father demands to see the bishop. The bishop comes in to kind of dispute this argument, and he agrees with his father that he does indeed need to be able to repay his father for what he has taken. So he says to him, I don't know what I'm going to do. He said, just give him what you have back, and we'll find enough money to be able to repay him back. But this is the right thing to do. This is the just thing to do. So he, right then and there, declares, I not only renounce my heritage and all that I have coming to me, but I also give everything that I own back to you in repayment for this loss. Literally taking the clothes off of his back, because those were clothes that his father gave him. His bishop takes off a cloak and wraps it around Francis, and just begins his new life. It's very symbolic in that he has now died to himself in order to give his life to Christ. So now let's think about that tension again, the tension between St. Francis, the man of the world, wanting to be a noble a knight, and this pious person who wants and knows Jesus Christ. And he has this encounter with Christ, and this desire for worldly goods just melts away. And this is the beginning of him rebuilding the church. So I think the important, and we'll stop here, and we certainly there's a lot of more stories, many more stories about St. Francis that we can go into. But I think this is the important part. So he believed that what he was hearing from the Lord in that moment in front of the church was to rebuild, to physically rebuild the church. But actually what the Lord was asking of him was to spiritually rebuild the church. So here we are with this new initiative, Together in Faith. And our first month's theme is about the domestic church. How do we rebuild the domestic church? How do we build up the domestic church? Spiritually. By learning first and foremost how to pray. By understanding the importance of spending some quiet time in prayer. And also spending some time together as a family to pray. We don't need to have big, long, beautiful prayers. We start off by anything that we learn to do by doing the basics well. So perhaps it's just sitting together at the dinner table and just saying, thank you, Lord, for the great gift of this meal. And that's it. Just spending it, making sure that it's a habit that everybody in the family wants to get together and just thank God for the gift of this meal. And then slowly as we get more comfortable with praying out loud together, then we can add a little bit more. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of this meal. I'm so grateful for the gift of my family, for my brothers, my sisters, my father, whatever, you know, whoever it is that is within your household that we're calling them, within your household, to say to just recognize that we need to center our day on Christ and on our faith. That's how we rebuild the church. And then we slowly kind of get used to exercising those muscles, those prayer muscles, and we start to branch out a little bit more. Perhaps then we can then move into saying a rosary together. Maybe it's just one decade of the rosary. We don't have to say all 5 decades of the rosary. So this is how we begin to learn how to pray. This is how we begin to learn how to center our lives on prayer. I have thought about my father and how he taught me how to pray. For me, it was coming back from college one day, walking into the bedroom with he and my mother as they were preparing for bed, and looking over and seeing my father on his knees praying. I said to myself, wow, I've never seen that. People really still do that? You know, it had a profound effect upon me. These are the small things that we can do that we can build up the domestic church by finding times to pray to each other. Perhaps it's sitting around the dinner table and doing what we call highs and lows. We go around the table and talk about what was our high for the day, what was our lows for the day. It opens up conversations. My high for the day is being able to have dinner here with my entire family. My low today was that I didn't do very well on tests, and I'm forlorn about it. This is our prayer. Our prayer is in how we live our life. So we build up the domestic church by making faith first and foremost. Because as St. John Paul II said, the first seminary is our home. So as we continue in this initiative of bringing faith and building up the domestic church within our households, this is how it begins. So I encourage you all during this month to think about being more intentional about your prayers, not only individually, when to start the day, to end the day, but together as a family. We get more comfortable being around each other, praying, and we just slowly build those muscles. So thank you for joining me for our first installment of Saint of the Month. And we just pray to God that you look towards this great gift that we have in the church, St. Francis, who rebuilt the church with his spiritual gifts of prayer and caring for each other and showing us to put faith in action. So God bless you and have a wonderful month. I look forward to getting together with you again next month.